please welcome Daniel Libeskind.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
So it would be great if you take us back to 2002. Why did you enter the competition for the World Trade Center?
Well, it's a very interesting story. I'll give you an anecdote. I was called by the LMDC, Lower Manhattan Development Corporation, to invite me as a juror of the competition. And I was thrilled. I turned to everyone and said, my God, this is amazing. I'm going to be a juror. And then there was a conflict. I had a previous lecture to a large audience, and I called the LMDC and I said, I can't be there at 9 o'clock. Can I be there at 10 o'clock? And they said, no. And I was totally crestfallen. And then the voice on the other side of the telephone said, well, Mr. Libeskind, if you can't be on the jury, you can be in the competition. So that's how I, but in truth, you know, I was in Berlin 13 years to build a Jewish museum, the first Jewish museum in Germany. And I worked on it for many years, 13 years. It opened, it was to open on 9/11/2001. And I went to the studio that day, turned to Nina and others, saying, you know, this is a great day because the first day I don't have to think about history because people can enter the museum and find, you know, have their own reactions to that history. And of course, by about 2:30 afternoon Berlin time, with the attacks on New York and Washington, the announcement was made that the museum will not open. And it did not open for the next 3-4 days because of the world uncertainty. So everything is interconnected. And at that moment in Berlin, when I saw those attacks on the screen, I said, I'm returning to New York. I had no idea, but I had to return to New York, and how lucky that I became involved and won the competition for the Ground Zero.
And talk to us a little bit about the design and what was your inspiration?
Well, you know, there were many competitors. I think it was the largest competition in the world. There were something like 5,000 architects competing from around the world, and each team sometimes had 100 people, experts in traffic, experts in technology, experts in economics, and so on.
And how big was your
I think three people. In fact, it was funny, when we came to the jury room, or, you know, it was a process, there would be, you know, 100 people in suits, and then we were in t-shirts, and, you know, three people just sweating. Anyway, the truth is that, how did it develop? You know, originally, interestingly enough, it was not even a competition. It was a design study for the Port Authority just to do, you know, throw different ideas together. Let's see what we can do. You know, the Port Authority, it's a big organization. But in fact, what happened is the public interest in the project drove the project competition into a focus, which the Port Authority could not control anymore. It was a political point. And of course, there were 7 finalists in the, some of them good friends of mine, famous architects. And I have to tell you this anecdote. We were at One Liberty Plaza, very close to here, at just almost the final days, one of the important meetings. And somebody said, does anybody want to go to Ground Zero? And all the architects said, no. It's much easier, much better to see it here. It was a rainy, miserable day in November. And I went down with Nina, and we decided, yeah, we want to go down. And, you know, when you take that walk down that ramp, which was there, 75 feet to the bedrock, your life will change. My life changed. I compare it to a swimmer under the pressure of water. If you go deeper and deeper into the ocean, you know, your head tends to explode. And when I touched the bedrock, I knew something happened to me. I touched that wall. The engineer said, there's the slurry wall. And I said, what is the slurry wall? Even though I studied architecture, I wasn't really clear. It's a gigantic dam, you know, holding the forces of the Hudson River. And I just suddenly had a vision that everything I've been doing in my office in Berlin at that time, just throw it out. I got the telephone, I called, it was late at night in Berlin, and I said, forget all the things, all the experts, it's not about that. It's about the fact that nothing should be built where people perished. Of course, this was not declared a sacred ground, it's just a piece of real estate. And you know how expensive a square inch of real estate in New York is. I said, build nothing. It was kind of a radical idea because at that point, every architect proposed large-scale megastructures in the center, but I thought it was just not right to build on that. And then I sort of put the buildings as far as possible away from a public place, which had the footprints, which had the idea of the waterfalls, which was my competition, and created a very practical project that separated buildings, not into megastructures, but discrete buildings that could be built as the economics allowed them to be built, because nobody had money to build megastructures. Nobody was gonna build these fantasy projects. Then I included a number of symbolic elements. Tower number one, 1776 feet high. I know it might sound obscure. It's the tallest tower in the United States. Doesn't matter. It's 1776, Declaration of Independence, the first document of human rights, actually. That'll never be surpassed by any building built in the world. Not that number. Then I included the wedge of light, a piazza which you still don't see, which will have, you know, between tower number two, south edge, and the central oculus of the path terminal, which records really the two times, 846 when the first tower was struck and 1028 when the second tower collapsed. You'll see it in light. And even I thought on a dim day, you'll be able to experience something of that peace in the skies of this beautiful city. And of course, create the connections, the subway connections. That's the important. We see it, we use it, just to connect the city back again. So I didn't see it as a standalone 16-acre site. I saw it as a public place. 8 acres are public place. It's a lot. You know that was my notion. Create as much public space as you can. And at the same time, create a social space that goes all the way to the bedrock, and with the story wall and the museum. Look, when I started working here on this project 2003, since that time, more than 250,000 people moved to Lower Manhattan. That's not a small number. It's a completely new city here. It's the epicenter of New York for the next 30 years. Who knows? So yes, that was kind of the struggle. Of course, not always easy. You have to make the compromises. Mm-hmm. You have to work with everyone. And yet when I look back, I see New York is an amazing city. Everybody has an agenda. Everybody has an ambition. Everybody has, you know, power. But somehow people at the end can come together. And many people at that time said to me, wouldn't you like to prefer to work in China, where they would just do it and nobody would ask questions? And I said, no. I prefer the struggles in a democracy because it makes the project meaningful instead of a glossy, gleaming thing which is completely empty of a spiritual sense of meaning.
We're now 16 years into this project. It takes a lot of determination and perseverance. How do you stay on it for so long?
Well, I have to be honest. If I didn't work with my wife, Nina, who's my partner, I don't think I could do it. She's not an architect, but she's my full partner. And you know, you have to have somebody to talk to late at night when things are really crushing onto your shoulders. You got to be lucky to have at least one person you can share, you know, the dilemmas, the pathos, the difficulties. But once you have that and you have faith that whatever it is, you're going to stay true. You know, you're not going to sell out your soul. You're not going to just do something because it's the easy way. Then you can do it, and you have to have faith. Without a faith, you'd never do it.
Yesterday, when I was at your studio, you told me that you're gonna go and travel for 22 consecutive days, crisscrossing Europe and Asia to go to all your projects.
Well, you know, I'm a different kind of architect, because if you're on a remote control, it's easy. Everything is remote. You just send instructions remotely. But if you're doing something which is even mildly unusual, mildly departing from the formula, something that has never been done, unprecedented, you have to be there. You have no choice. This is actually what Isaac Bashevis Singer, the great Yiddish writer, said. We have free will. We have no choice. We have free will. We have no choice. That's right. We have free will. We have no choice. So we have to go to the places, whether they're in Africa or in Asia, wherever you build, we're building, and meet with the people, look them in the eye, and there's no substitute. Artificial intelligence is fantastic, but it's never going to replace that special contact you have with a human being, which is ineffable. You can't calculate it. It's not something you can calculate. It's just the energy and spiritual connection you have with somebody else's soul, not just their body. So yeah, you have to travel, and you know, I like it, actually. I enjoy traveling because we travel together, and the world is so interesting. You know what's interesting? That every place I go to, think about it, New York City, everybody thinks they're in the center of the world. Made in New York City, you're in the center of the world. You go to London, of course, center of the world. You go to a village in China, it's a center of the world. You go to Africa and Kenya, center of the world. Every place is a center of the world, which means there is no center of the world. Really, they are mutually exclusive. And such an illusion about, you know, what is important, that's another thing. So building even something small in an obscure place might be a breakthrough, you know, in the center of the world.
So I imagined after 22 days on the road, you're going to be a little bit exhausted. How do you develop resilience?
Okay, it's very easy.
How you get going.
I'll give you my secret technique. You can travel anywhere in the world. You don't need any books. You don't need your, you know, screens. You don't need to take any secret, you know, comfort shoes or anything like that. All you need to do is take a book of poetry and memorize it. Now, I have a technique, you know, because the mind is an empty shell, basically. There's nothing in the mind. You know, those folds don't form if you don't do something to them. So my idea was, it's an empty room. You can't live in an empty room. You've got to furnish it with some table, a chair, you know. So I started, for fun, memorizing poems of my favorite poet, Emily Dickinson. One poem, 10 poems, 20 poems, 40 poems, 50 poems, keep going. Then I discovered, wow, even better, not better, but from a different angle, memorize sonnets of Shakespeare. They're so beautiful. You always have some amazing thing. Let me compare you to the summer's day. Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Wow, the minute you have those words, you don't have to, you are never bored in an airplane. And even at a boring meeting, you know, instead of listening to that sort of sound coming through some boring person, the poem in your mind, and then you really are resilient. You get healthy. You can be inspired.
Let's talk about a little bit about your background. You're born to Holocaust survivors in
Poland.
In Poland, post-war Poland, which I imagine was a pretty grim place. How has that shaped you and influence your architecture?
Very much so. You know, because evil ideologies are not just sort of abstractions. If you live under one, I grew up after the Holocaust. My parents were themselves survivors. So I understood viscerally that everybody around me had been murdered. You know, millions of Jews, 6 million Jews, and 20 million others, or 50 million others, as a result of Hitler's idea of genocide of the Jews. Millions of others, Russians, Germans, Poles, Paris. So I grew up in that atmosphere of antisemitism and of state-sponsored communism, very powerful in my childhood. It wasn't just reading the newspapers. It was just walking on the streets and understanding the fear, the darkness, the convention, the enforced convention, the fact that no one could smile, the fact that everybody was scared of the next day. So when you grow up under a system like that, you learn something. It's not from a book. You don't have to study it in history. You just learn what a political evil is, and then you celebrate the ideas that you appreciate, which is how to be free. It's not always easy. You have to fight, sometimes physically. And then I was lucky to go to Israel. You know, it was amazing to see a country where, you know, Jews were, you know, policemen, Jews were garbage collectors, Jews were prostitutes, Jews had amazing freedom, possibilities. And then, of course, I had a second promised land, which was the Bronx. I came to the Bronx. How fantastic to wind up in the Bronx with no language. You know, my parents were, you know, workers in factories. I think I was the first person to you know, for my, you know, they had no chance to go to schools. Yet my parents, who were working people, never went to school. You know, my father, I think, went to grade 3, my mother a little more. I used to be a professor at Harvard, Yale. I thought my parents were much better than all the professors I met, more wise, more intelligent about the meaning of life. So anyway, that was kind of the path that I took, and I think it had a big influence on me, definitely. That's why I don't like working in a totalitarian system, wherever it is, the mindset that wants to authorize things in an illegitimate way. And that's everywhere. It's not just in systems that we find bad, but yeah. So that's a little bit, but you know, in between, I was a professional musician. That was also something that, because I was destined to be an architect because I played the wrong instrument. Because in Poland, you know, I played the accordion, which really, you know, everybody always laughs because the accordion is the music, you know, an instrument of gypsies, of poor people. But I played it because my parents were too afraid to bring the piano because of our neighbors. They were scared. The Jews are bringing the piano. So they brought me the piano in a suitcase. And I thought, okay, it doesn't exactly look like a piano, but half of it looks a little bit like a piano. But I became really, you know, I loved the instrument. And when I came to Israel, somebody said, why don't you compete in the America-Israel Prize for Music, which I did, and I won it, together with Yitzhak Perlman. The year before was Daniel Barenboim. You know, not many people won the prize, maybe five. And as I always say, Isaac Stern, who was the head of the jury, I met him many years after that. He said, you know, we gave you the prize, you were the only person who didn't become famous in music. But I said to him, the reason I'm still in music, I just changed my instrument. I dropped the accordion. I have another instrument. It's architecture, which is an instrument. It's a means to an end. Create a better life. Create a nice space. Create something interesting, something memorable. So yes, that's a kind of a checkered life. It's not. I never understood how people calculate to do something. Some people have a calculation to do something. Calculations never work, in my view. You know, never calculate. Just go with it. You know, I'm not a Zen person, but I understand what they meant.
Do you think your upbringing is sort of the reason why your most famous projects are rather dramatic and sort of, you know, if it's 9/11 or if it's the Holocaust or other sort of the tragic things in history?
No, I think we make too much of a separation between, you know, what we like and what we don't want to think about. But life is full of other things. It's all of it is important. We can repress trauma. You know, many people at Ground Zero wanted to forget about what happened, just built, you know, happy big buildings with a lot of life in the center. But trauma cannot be repressed. This is Emily Dickinson. To fill a gap, insert the thing that caused it. Block it up with the other, and it will yawn the more. You cannot solder an abyss with nothing, right? So you have to face a trauma. We are living in a trauma. We're living during world wars. There are wars going on. Americans, too, are dying. So those projects have a, of course, they have a meaning, but they have to do with memory. And to me, memory is actually the real ground of architecture. It's not a piece of real estate. You look at it, you can build something, a building here, a building there, a city here, a city there. It's really the ground. When you just start digging, you are connected to the ground, to the ground of memory. Everywhere there's memory. You cannot obliterate it. You cannot kill it. You cannot forget about it. And that's why I think even a house in a picturesque, you know, landscape has to be based on memory. And look at us. We go home, we go to the office, we go somewhere with our friends or with loved ones. It's all about memory.
I want to talk about one project that you have a lot of passion for that you currently work on, which is the building you are working on for the Maggie's cancer charity.
Oh, yes. Well, Maggie's is a very unusual institution. It's a place for cancer, but it's not medical. It's about the social and emotional support. And who does not know cancer patients? Who does not have in their family, in their loved ones, someone that has had this terrible disease? So the Maggie's is a fantastic institution, not government funded, but next to hospitals that deal with cancer. But it's a place where once you get, you know, your diagnosis, which is apparently 5 minutes, you're told, and what do you do? What happens to you? You're lost. So that's what Maggie's are. It's a center that you come and you can talk to people, you can have a cup of coffee, you can meet others, you can meet experts, you can meet friends, you can, you know, it's kind of a beautiful idea. And so I was lucky to be asked by Maggie's to design next to the Royal Free Hospital in London, which is one of the biggest hospitals, back in the kind of parking lot, not some sort of fantastic piece of real estate, just a leftover piece of a parking lot, to design something beautiful, something for people who really need the healing power of architecture. And that's what architecture ultimately is. architecture is, I think, the profession of hope, because it's a sermon in concrete, the sermon in glass. It's not just a utilitarian object like a car or a washing machine or an air conditioner. It's something different. It has a cultural depth to it, and it has a certain depth of physiognomy that we need. We relate to architecture. Even when it's ugly, we still find a corner to sleep in. And so that's what Maggie's is. It's a wonderful project. And of course, that's a wonderful thing. It's a very tiny project.
So what is your favorite project so far?
I always say the next one. It's like choosing kids. You know, of course, the first kid is always, you know, Jewish Museum was my first building. I really never built a building before, nor did I design a building before. And my last project, well, there are many, but Ground Zero is still not finished, maybe 85% finished. But it's still, you know, I'm involved in it. But, you know, there's always new projects, you know, in Africa and unexpected places with interesting people where you can learn a lot. And that's another secret to architecture, that with every building, if you're open-minded, you discover something. Wouldn't it be boring if you did the same thing over and over again? Every day, it would be heartless, you'd die. But if you just find a margin of freedom, and that's what I think, you know, is the most important. Find, you know, how do you find, nobody is giving you freedom. You have to take freedom. No, nobody's offering freedom to anybody. At any time of history, nobody was offered freedom. You have to sort of fight for it, get it. Otherwise, it'll disappear. As Benjamin Franklin said about this country, it's a republic if you can keep it. Can we keep it? Who knows? Depends on us.
Gentlemen, Daniel Libeskind.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.